All right. I'll let you get settled. While you do that, I'm going to call the meeting to order and perform roll call. But before I do that, I'd like to announce that this meeting is being recorded, courtesy of Jay. Roll call. Director Brandt, aye. Director Thurlow?
Here.
Or, yeah, not aye, here. Director Geis?
Here.
Awesome.
Let me ask just a comment.
Yes.
Since we have a board member that's recording it, what's the repository for these recordings, and what is their status as an official legal recording of the meeting? Not to throw.
I'm not entirely sure.
Okay. Well, maybe tomorrow at the
policy, I can say,
at the policy committee.
There's going to need to be.
There should be some discussion about where. That. I mean, we should be recorded. That's fine. But then, where do we post it? Where does the public get access?
I can tell you that right now, as the board secretary, I don't have access to like the original files, and I'm not doing any sort of a repository thing. But if the board directs me to, then that would.
Yeah, I think the other important thing is that if you are the secretary or somebody is recording minutes, you're going to maybe need to go back to those recordings to have them somehow available.
Yeah.
That you could say, oh gosh, what did we really do?
Yeah. And they are publicly available.
Okay.
They're posted from the YouTube channel IV is a City, which is a YouTube channel that Jay runs.
Okay.
And so I, in refining the minutes and making sure that I'm being consistent, I have been going back and looking at that.
Okay.
So, okay, thank you for those comments, though, George. At this time, we'd like to move on to public comment. At this time, members of the public may speak on any matter under the subject jurisdiction of the Formation Committee. Do we have any public comment? Awesome, that's great. So welcome to introductions. At this time, I just want to say welcome. I think the Formation Committee is going to be one of the most important committees under the IVCSD Board of Directors. We have a lot of work to do, a lot of things that are going to be one-time only things, and then eventually can be transitioned into a more continuous sort of policy. But you know, things that we've spoken about and that the board has tasked us with taking care of, a lot of things are going to be one-time things that we're going to have to work on. Move on to item number two, elect a chair of the Formation Committee and set the roles and responsibilities of that chairperson. So before we talk about people, I do want to say that one of the things that we spoke about at the board was that there's going to need to be written committee reports from each committee. So I think that when we set the roles of the chairperson should definitely be writing up those reports. Write that down. Does anyone have nominations for a chairperson?
Well, since you added that qualification, we got to write the reports, and I would nominate Spencer as chair of this committee.
Do you think you have time to do it with all the other stuff you have to do?
I'd personally rather not, just because of all the other stuff.
So I have an idea that I've penciled up here.
Yeah.
It's kind of a little bit, it kind of goes along with, maybe I just jump a little bit around on the agenda a little bit. Where I don't think this should be a Brown Act committee, because I don't think it works. Because it's like I wrote something to Spencer, and he goes, remember, we're a Brown Act committee. You can only just give me like one liner to discuss what to put on the agenda. I go, well, it's a concept.
Well, and we should discuss that once.
Yeah,
we
yeah.
Get to
I'm only bringing that up in terms of a sense of if we as a committee had a working agenda, and I mean throwing stuff onto the committee like, you know, we're going to do a treasury, what are we going to do for communications? If we had a laundry list of those things that the board could refer to us, other committees could refer to us, the public could make suggestions that we put something on through the formation committee like today onto a working list. I could envision that being the regular report that goes to the board, mm-hmm. which says, here's all the things that we have to work on mm-hmm. conceptually over a long period of time. We either got it done, or we, you know, write a written report on that. Let's say it's the, you know, rental of office space. We could say how the progress was going on that, and that's what we worked on this week. But that's kind of my idea to shorten that process of trying to make motions in this, first trying to get agenda items, mm-hmm. and then making motions in this meeting on those agenda items about what we do, and try and streamline that process. But I can show you a little bit more when we get mm-hmm. off to the number eight, you know?
Yeah, and I will definitely echo some of those feelings once we get to number eight. But I think right now we just need to elect a chair. So
this guy's really got a thing about moving agenda items. Yeah. I've just discovered that. So you need to tell me, because you know what, the other thing is there's going to be a whole bunch more committees, and they're going to be just as important as this committee. But it seems to me the other piece of this is, you know, a lot of what we're going to be doing is stuff that Bob has experience doing, and also tasks where it's going to be easy for him as the chair of the committee to pick up the phone and call somebody and say.
So that was my one other thought is that a lot of the tasks that I already put on just an inventory of lists, you know, were, oh, I could easily accomplish that, like maybe with insurance. Mm-hmm. You know, I meet Mike Gazzoni at a going away party. Mm-hmm. I said, hey, Mike, am I covered for insurance? Mike goes, yeah, you aren't going to lose your house. I go, good.
Yeah.
Because I'm an appointed board member, the board mm-hmm. gives me coverage.
Yeah.
And so I said, oh, well, how about, he said, but you want other coverage for the district. I go, well, we get that. He turned around, called Ray Romataro at the county the next day. Ray calls me and says, what kind of coverage do you think you need? And I said, tell us what kind of coverage is available. He says, well, I've done coverages for other small special districts, and we did it through Alliant. Boom, he sends me the application. I go, oh, well, I don't know if I'm, you know, I don't have that communications authority. I don't know what the protocol, we don't have a protocol authority. And I have the application, but I haven't done anything with it. So
yeah.
I'm trying to look for that feeling. If I, you know, maybe I could be the chair of the formation committee and see how it works. Mm-hmm. And if it doesn't work, then we'll make you the chair.
That's totally fine. That's totally fine with me. Yeah,
because I've got another couple of committees that you need to chair in my pocket. So so I'll withdraw my motion.
Okay. I move to nominate Bob as the chair of the formation committee.
Second. Call the question. Unless there's some public.
Any, can ask us questions.
Any, why?
Any public input?
It's very important.
Okay.
That sounds
well, funny. Half of you can't talk because you violate the Brown Act.
I can. Okay. I can't. Okay.
I
can talk. It's just he can't.
I know. Talk.
Yeah. He's a fly.
I'm sorry.
I mean, I have some public.
He's just hanging out.
The things you were talking about, but not the
nomination. Yeah, no, I'm not worried about the chair.
Okay. Go for the question.
All right, call to question. Director Brandt, aye. Director Geis.
Do I have to abstain for myself?
Abstain. Director Thurlow.
Aye.
Motion passes 2-0-1, one abstention.
You're taking minutes for this meeting, Spence?
You know what, I'll take the minutes, just this one time.
Okay.
Thanks, George.
Just like Gina, just this one time. Yeah. I'm going to let you use my phone once.
All right. Well, without further ado, Mr. Geis, if you'd like to...
On the setting the roles and responsibilities for the chairperson?
Yeah.
Do you think we could continue that part to the more towards the end of the meeting after we talk about some of the issues? And
that's fine by me.
If we think the chairman should do that, maybe it turns into a role and responsibility. So, well, that should be the goal of the chair. So I think I have a little
great.
Bit more vision about what the roles and responsibilities are now if I just think about it in context.
That's fine by me.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, moving on to item number 3, overview, goal setting, and mission statement. we need to craft a brief list of goals in the one sentence mission statement for the committee. And if you want to move this to the end too, so that we have a more accurate sort of appraisal of what it is that we're going to be doing, I'd be okay with that, unless anyone has any.
I took a stab at it. I said establish administrative services for the district in accordance with statutes that guide district operations. If that.
That's fine with me.
That's fine with me. I don't think that this needs to be too in depth.
That's good, yeah.
The only reason I put in accordance with the statute that guide district operations, there's probably in the CSD law, there's probably some general guidance in the statutes that kind of tells us where to go. And,
mm-hmm.
I think
that's
when
right.
You see my inventory of lists, you'll get more what I mean. But we could come back to that before we finalize it.
Yeah, that's fine by me. You're,
I don't know if that's the mission or the goal.
Yeah, I think that...
if I was going to establish a mission, it's to assist the board of directors in carrying out their duties.
Yeah, well, exactly. That's the other thing. The thing that the board directed us to do was a one-sentence mission. Well, not a one-sentence, but a mission statement. Mission statements are typically one sentence, so I threw that in there.
Yeah, I was trying to say that the one sentence is, the formation committee is going to look at the administrative duties of
mm-hmm.
the organization, and after that, hopefully we're terminated.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. I don't see this being, and again, this is probably a conversation for agenda item number 7, but I don't see this committee being something that is necessary in the long term.
Right.
This is a lot of laying the groundwork. So yeah, I like what you had written.
So will you send that language to me? For
yeah,
the
I'll
minutes?
Give you this at the end
okay.
when I can introduce
okay.
it as, it's not part of the what we sent out, so I'll introduce
yeah.
it at the end as future agenda items.
Okay.
I was going to mail it to you guys, but I said, well, that's not a good idea.
No.
Yeah.
So is that...
Well, you'll see
goals.
When I
so
send
goals,
it.
We're
going to
talk about
stuff.
Goals when we get down there, too.
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
I think that
right.
the goal
that's
specifically
good.
Is what compelled me to say we should
okay.
leave this to the end.
Okay.
Awesome. Any public input? Sweet.
Okay.
So moving on to agenda item number 4, consider action and recommendations regarding online presence of the IVCSD. So for those of you who didn't get a chance to pick it up, I printed out a handout which I will eventually, I'll figure out how to attach it to the agenda at some point in time, or to this agenda. It's from the California Special Districts Association, and it is regarding, here, let me pull it up on my computer, because I actually don't have a copy in front of me, but it's regarding the, oh, thanks, George. It's called Everything You Need to Know About Online Compliance, written by the California Special Districts Association. It goes over a number of different things that special districts need to be in compliance with for their websites. Which is something that the board specifically it specifically was mentioned at our last meeting, was that once you get a website, once you've created a website, there are all sorts of little things that you have to make sure that you're coming into compliance with. The state of California continues to pass more legislation to bring special district websites, to force them into the 21st century per se. And so I believe all of these things are outlined in this document. So I really think, I'll say at the outset that I think that a website should be a priority. I think that when we talk about it, sometimes you may get the impression that this is something that's going to take, you know, consultants or what have you to build, but I really don't think that's the case at all, especially having looked at a number of other different community services district websites that are of kind of comparable size and level of services. Of course, right now our level of service is zero, but I think that creating a website is something that can really be done very quickly. And I think that the main functionality of it, of course, is going to be putting the agenda on the website, making sure we're noticing the meetings, making sure we have an archive of minutes, agendas, agenda attachments, a calendar of our meetings, things like that. And so I really think that this is something that we should move on. I want to go over the handout really quickly. There's the definition of open data, which is in regards to making sure that the agenda making sure that public records are indexable by search engines and whatnot. I won't go too deep into that. Section 508 makes sure that's of the Rehabilitation Act of 1973. That's making sure that your website is compatible with different sorts of technology that people with different sorts of disabilities use, such as I think it's like a braille reader kind of thing. Making sure that, like, if you have certain things turned on, if you have a disability, say that you have a sight disability, then you can mouse over something and get it read to you. Things like that. Making sure that that is compatible with that software. The Public Records Act and ensuring that public records are available online. The Brown Act, of course, making sure that there is adequate time of which the agenda has been posted on the website for. Financial transaction reports, which is something I think that we'll be talking about in depth a little more later on a future item. But overall, I really think that we should develop some sort of a plan and get moving on this.
So are you thinking of volunteers? So here's an issue about volunteers that we're going to jump right into, which we're going to either deal with or the policy committee, and that is, I think it's very dangerous for a public agency to use volunteers. And the reason is that we're not a nonprofit, we're not a charitable organization, we're a government agency, and somebody volunteers for us and then later comes back and says, you know what, I did all this work for you and you didn't pay me, and that's a violation of California labor law. And so it's just like using unpaid interns, mm-hmm. and the experience of at least one TV station in town, which is you get sued. And here we are, we don't have an attorney. So I would only say that if we go into the area of having interns create value, or not interns, because that's where I was going to go, but if we have volunteers who are unpaid create things of value, I think we need to be very, very careful about mm-hmm. how we do that.
I also think we should have a protocol that, number one, we have an inventory of things that the entire board gets to vote on, that gets to be posted on the website. And I think if we use that as a little structure, mm-hmm. that then somebody on the board's gonna understand those things and say, that's not a very good idea, or we can't do that and comply with those standards. So what I was thinking of is for the initial website, and hopefully we could design a framework for the website that we could build out over time, mm-hmm. we don't try and hit a home run at the beginning.
I agree.
But we start off and say, hey, here's the profiles of the directors, here's their contact information, here's the agendas, here's the minutes, and build from there. And if we just get up a basic site, then we can consider other items to add, and hopefully we build the website where we can add and, you know, just have a good framework. Of course, people end up reworking their websites because they don't think of all the framework at the beginning, and so
yeah.
It's how creative can we be in the framework to efficiently add stuff. I don't know how IV has done their website, or if you're up to date, or if it's a struggle, or how you do it.
You contract with someone, right?
Yeah, but webmaster.
Yeah, we pay someone to do it. I mean, everything's very official. It's, again, it's minutes, it's agendas, it's policies, it's ordinances, mm-hmm. it's the list of who's on what committee, and then it posts, you know, meetings, and also these meetings, your committee meetings. But we don't have, there's no director going in there and doing anything on their own. There's no,
yeah.
willy-nilly. It's strictly through the general manager in you know, with the webmaster that we pay. I'm not sure what we pay him, but we do pay him.
But there's also tons of information about parks on there as well, which is something
yes.
that we don't have. We don't have any information the way that Goleta Water has about like paying your bill and stuff like
right.
that, because we don't have any of that
right.
stuff.
We build
place.
That over
so
time.
I
yeah.
really want to echo what you're saying about how this is going to be a sort of a bare bones thing to begin
right.
with.
Right.
It's going to be a, it would be, or at least that's what I'm envisioning, is you know, agenda and attachments, making sure they're noticed on time, minutes, profiles of directly their contact information, meeting calendar, you know,
yeah.
things like that.
Very simple.
So how do you want to start it? Did you want to say something?
I just want to say off George's point that an intern that handles all this that's like continuous seems like a best bet for now. But to get something started now in an intern.
Okay. Is that what you were thinking? Were you thinking we could get an intern? Because again, that gets us away from the volunteer.
Yeah. I mean, long term, I think that is definitely the solution. But I think that we need to be thinking about in the interim too, because we're already one of the things that we were hearing at the last meeting was folks who were coming and saying, you know, I don't think you guys did a good enough job of noticing this meeting and letting people know about it, which is something that is just part of being, you know, a government agency, is
yeah.
that you're going to get people who
yeah.
don't feel like they were included in the
always,
process, but.
Always.
Do we have any webmasters on the board? Is Jay a webmaster?
I'm actually not sure. Do you know if he does web design? I know he does programming.
I mean, he did his own like campaign website a year ago, but I remember him saying at the full board meeting last week that he wanted to like distance himself from that whole process, like specifically because like he's so deep into that.
Yeah. No, and I understand you wouldn't want the impression that a director was like
right.
being contracted by the board, because that would
right.
get into weird territory.
So that's the other issue, is that we I have a staff person who has created an Ida Vista website for us, for our office.
Yeah.
But that I worry that that would create the same weirdness, which would be a paid university employee was creating the website.
Yeah. Well, Jonathan, how did Ivy like Self-Governance Initiative do their website?
We just used Cameron's WordPress account, so we can do something similar this time, if we want, for now, like for the next month.
Yeah. In the interim,
yeah. IdaVistaCSD.com, I do still have it, so we can just route that to anything.
So what if we were to make a request? I mean, Cameron's working for the first district right now.
Yeah.
Is that going to be weird if we ask the first district office?
What he does in his private time is also.
And then he becomes a volunteer. And
true.
That makes me.
Yeah. Well, what if we? I mean.
We can have the IVACDC do it as a nonprofit, and then whoever volunteers or is on the board for that, it's.
You know, that might be the solution, which is for us to turn to an Isla Vista nonprofit that's you're a 501c3, so you have some, and then we ask them on our behalf to do that, and then you guys
will handle.
Yes, Peggy?
Yeah, part of me feels like there should be a couple of your board members involved though in the process.
It just seems that it's going to be so, if what you're talking about
yeah.
is so darn simple, it's just Isla Vista
yeah.
Community Services District.
I think if we use the board members as the protocol to just have a, say, we want to add this to the online agenda and
right.
let the board
yeah.
vote on it. So the first one you
right.
might outline and say it's
right.
going to be minutes and agendas and board profile and meeting
yeah.
times, and make that simple list, and we bring it to the board and say, we're going to use the IBCSD nonprofit to create this, and what environment we're creating it in. I don't know what.
Well, here's.
What you're describing, I can also learn to do myself in an afternoon and create.
Yeah.
It's like the simplest version.
Yeah, because I know I've used similar platforms and actually know them pretty well too.
Yeah.
They are super easy to use, and they. I know for a fact,
as
actually.
As long as they can't be hacked and.
People yeah, well, that's what I was going to say.
Everything's
yeah.
going to get
hacked. What I was going to say is I know for a fact that
I don't want them to mess up
they're
with your
up
picture,
to
you know?
They're up to like disability requirements.
Yeah.
all those things are definitely up to disability requirements and as well yeah. as what's it called? Just yeah, general accessibility and security. Yeah, Peggy.
Isn't there a cost to doing a web page? Like an upkeep cost? Like first you have to pay for it, and then do you have to pay for it monthly?
Depends where you're going to put it. Where you're going to put? Where are we going to put it in terms of a server?
Well,
that's the cost.
So Jonathan owns this domain already.
Yeah,
and he said
right.
he wanted to upkeep it for some short period of time, right?
But yeah, I already paid for it in December, so we have
right.
it until next December.
Yeah. Also, like extraneously. I was wondering if you guys had thought about getting like a .gov, because let's see.
I think that's a long-term conversation.
All right.
But
that's
what's our current one? IVCSD.com?
IVCSD.com.
Because, Peggy, what's Parks? Is it ivparks.org?
Not sure.
It is.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
And I would just, for you guys, suggest maybe a list of things for the board, like what the content would be,
right.
like, and then have the board sign off on that,
yeah,
and
right.
then
that's
you can't get yourselves into trouble.
Right.
You've made a
that's
recommendation.
True, yeah.
They've
right.
approved it. We want
right.
agenda calendar, minutes,
okay.
committee meetings, you know, Jay's tapes, and then
true.
That way there's direct marching orders to whatever.
Right. Okay, what's our list? We got our list ready.
Yeah.
Agenda, minutes, profiles of directors, calendar.
Okay, I'm gonna make a motion that we approve that list. That. First of all, a motion to the board to recommend to the board that we ask the IVCSD to
IVCDC.
Create
IVCDC.
I know, yeah. It's the
CDC.
We're working on changing
it. IVCDC to create a website, a simple website, we use that word, simple website, that would include, and then you give me the list again.
Agenda, minutes, contact information and profiles of each director, and a calendar of meetings.
And videos
and audio recordings.
Okay, agenda.
And committee meetings also.
And committee and committee
yeah.
meetings, yes.
And is it using the Isla Vista CSD.com URL? Is that what that is, a URL?
Is it a .com or .org? Tangentially, what was Josh Plotkey talking about in regards to the website when he came the other day?
If I heard him correctly, I think what he was doing was he was trying to compile the criminal record data and the arrest data. Was it that thing?
He mentioned something about having control.
He owns like the name.
You should talk to him.
Yeah.
He might have the domain.
He
said he got it, and then he gave it to you. Okay, gotcha.
Yeah.
So
okay.
So the next as part of this discussion is we need, and I don't know if you want to take this to the board, we do need to negotiate with you, Jonathan, to obtain that or
yeah.
to come up with something that's different.
Yeah, I can donate it.
That would be great.
That would
yeah.
be wonderful.
It's our first
we
donation.
Yeah,
that
we're gratefully accept that, but
accept,
but
yeah.
you'll do that in a way. Will you? Will you do that in a traditional?
Yeah,
okay.
Because once he donates the domain name, then there needs to be standards and policies in place for who maintains it. Who's gonna have the login? Who's gonna point it at the correct server?
Luckily, the website that I own it through allows you to transfer a domain to another account.
That's right.
Easily. Which is what Josh did to me. I didn't even have to have an account on the website. I just said, give it to this person. Here's your email. Figure it out.
Yeah, and I know how to do that. I've done that before. It's a pretty easy process if you've done it in times.
Yeah, it's easy to steal people's websites that much. And once we went to lostindependent.com.
And do you think we should do a value on that and then record it on the books?
I don't know. Yeah.
I'll think about that.
Once you... That'll be part of when we get to item number 8.
Yeah.
Okay.
Can I have a second to my motion?
I second. And I don't know if I should recuse myself from this vote, given that I'm on the board of directors for the IVCDC.
I don't think so.
I don't think so.
When it comes before the actual board,
yeah.
I'll mention that. But yeah.
Okay.
All right.
Am I in charge now? All in favor? I'm not. Am I in charge now?
Yeah,
you are
in charge.
You
oh.
just start asserting yourself.
You start acting.
You
like
guys just have to remind
gotta,
me. All in favor? Say
aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Motion I will passes. When I come to my list at the end.
Yeah.
Regarding this issue,
just want to expand it to a broader issue about communications, which, you know, is the telephone and the district email address, board member email addresses, maybe how to do some URLs consistently, and so if we're board members, we could all do them similarly if we decide
to. For the email addresses?
Yeah, like.
Makes sense.
Ethan sent out his. It's ebertrand at gmail.com. And
yeah.
I was going to set one up that said geis at gmail.com.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So
I. And I've set one up that's separate.
On Google?
Yeah, George.
That's another
George
thing.
George Thurlow, CSD
yeah.
at gmail.com.
Okay, use CSD. So I was hoping we could, you know, put that all in the address, and maybe I should put, maybe we'll get around, we can have suggestions about that and decide what the best format is.
I think there should be an item on the agenda for the next meeting that just asks board members to, like, basically we just need to create a compilation of all these email addresses so that, one, they're publicly available, and two,
yeah, I didn't,
all the directors
I
know,
didn't do
I have
mine
too.
I didn't do mine yet on Gmail, but now that I hear you use Thurlow CSD at Gmail, I
yeah.
might go Geis CSD at Gmail.
Yeah.
That would be a better identifier.
And that's what I've done just through my own private thing. It's like IVCSD at SpencerBrandt.com. And I've already sent you emails, so everyone should have my email. But it needs to be publicly available too.
Yeah.
Okay, sweet.
You've got to realize you're talking to a moron on emails.
Can't be worse than the Hillary Clinton campaign. Okay, would you like to move on to number five? Consider action and recommend.
Just 1 second. So are we not talking about social media pages within this context? You guys are just talking about doing a website. Because you
yeah.
have that on there.
Mm. Oh, you have an email address too.
That's
you
right.
Mean in terms of Facebook and all that stuff.
Yeah, and I would just advise don't do it yet.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Yeah. I'm kind of with you on that.
And I mean, we ran into problems, you know, with our
yeah.
Facebook over time, and
uh-huh.
not so many problems, but yeah, that should be controlled by, you know, an official entity and not just
yeah.
willy nilly.
Mm-hmm.
But if people have access to your website, then people
yeah.
can. Hook into links, and they can do their own Facebook things
mm-hmm.
from the official site.
Well, can
yeah.
we break this thing up? Consider recommending a plan to create online presence for the district, including but not limited to social media pages. Are we going to pursue social media pages at this time?
Not.
No.
I don't think I want to
no.
at this time.
So,
I think we should state for the record at least the reason why I don't think it's a good idea, which is that when you have someone in charge of a Facebook page, it is by nature inextricably linked to a personal profile, and there's not that kind of wall of separation that there is when you're talking about having a, for example, having the CDC manage a website through a platform that is, you know, kind of its own independent thing.
So maybe on this, the minutes for this, we can have A, what we decided.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe on B, we should just say, we do not recommend social media pages at this time.
Mm-hmm.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
All right.
All
awesome.
In favor?
Call to question.
Aye.
Aye.
All right. And we can go C. We already did the email at. Is the email
Wait,
address.
Did you vote on that?
I did.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes. We did.
So is the email address the same as the URL we just talked about? That's different, right? That's we just talked about a district website. Now are we going to
yeah.
have an email address?
For the email address, I think that our recommendation to the board should be that each board member create an email address specifically for district business through Gmail or some other email platform so as to keep the work separate.
Is that a motion? This
yes.
can be seen.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, second. All in favor?
Aye.
So let me just do we want to put any protocol out about what we think the recommended format of that URL address is? So, just as I said,
the
we
URL
got
or the Gmail address?
The Gmail. ebertrand@gmail.com. Your G Thurlow CSD at gmail.com, your
Yeah.
I don't think that part of it is so important.
I don't think it's that important.
No. I don't think it's that important at all.
I have a personal email on the Iowa Director Park website.
Okay, we'll leave it, you know, we'll leave it free for
life. For all I care, your email that you use for CSD business is like bobby24@gmail.com. It doesn't matter. It's as long as that each director has an email account that they know is specifically for district
business. I was
just
thinking that if a public was out there and they want to get a hold of director,
yeah,
they might remember email addresses if they were more consistent.
That's true. I think that in the future, once we have control of the domain name, iowavistacsd.org or .com, whichever it is, that's definitely something that should be looked into, is getting director's email
that
addresses.
Just gets confusing switching. So the more consistent we could get at the beginning.
So
what's yours again?
Our trains have already left the station, so I already got an archive.
Okay. I'll follow your train.
That will soon be
requested
under public.
And we can just put that in there. Here are the ones that exist so far.
Yeah. Well, mine, you want mine. Then mine is ivcsd@spencerbrandt.com.
I'm wondering, when you put this on here, were you meaning an email address, though, for the CSD?
Yes.
That there's a way to
contact,
not just individual board members, but...
But that's down the road.
Yeah.
I think that's down the road. Because I think that what we should do now is, in this very early stage, just tell the public, contact these board members and here's their email addresses if you have business.
Specifically, I think that the board president is a good point of contact.
Yeah.
It should be that until
you guys have maybe we
should. So, and even for example, on these Brown Act notice minutes, the point of contact is the president of the board, Ethan Bertrand, phone number and email. And Ethan.
So why don't we make a recommendation that the board point of email address, point of contact for the public at this point in time is the president, and his is
ebertrand@gmail.com. It's ebertrand.ivcsd@gmail.com.
Let me just point
out. Oh, it is?
It's on the back of the agenda at the very
bottom.
Is that
the one he just set up?
It's the one he just set up.
Oh, he has IVCSD in it.
It's ebertrand.ivcsd@gmail.com.
ebertrand. Okay. So just for point of clarification.
And you use CSD in yours, not IVCSD.
No, I just use CSD. Is Ethan the president of the board of the IV Community Services District, or is he the chair of the board of the IV? I think somehow we need to clarify.
It's the president of the board. Yeah. So California government code specifies that
it
should be termed as the president.
Okay,
yeah.
That's good.
So
that's
we're just being consistent with that.
Okay.
And then on the last one, which is the last one we didn't cover, profiles. What do we think?
Did we never finish that recommendation for?
Well, we never
profiles.
That piece of it. What do we mean by profiles? And
I think that was a mess up on my part because of what I meant. So profiles.
Are we saying a picture?
I meant it in conjunction with social media, and I didn't realize I had already put social media.
So the motion,
pages.
The original motion, though, included directors, and. So we'll just leave that.
And that's in the context of the website. So there's different things going on here.
So the profile of a director on the website, is it going to have his picture, name, email address?
I think the main thing is going to be the name, their duty as appointed by the board, and their email address.
Okay.
Yes.
Basically, that's all we have. We're not fancy. It's the name, board chair, board vice chair, board members, and then we also and then our email, our contact address, and then we have our committees, who's on what committee.
Mm-hmm.
That's also.
So,
definitely.
So
we don't have pictures and.
So I can make a recommendation that said the profile of board member will include their name, their position, and their email address.
That sounds great.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right. So we covered every issue, like ABCD, we did that in four.
And should we make it clear that this is a temporary our recommendation no. are these. No. These are recommendations.
No, temporary for 10 years. Temporary.
Okay. Yeah. Sweet. Yeah. Yeah. Because we're sitting here and you're talking about the fancy profiles and I'm thinking that sounds like a great project for an ambitious staff
member of the board.
So,
an ambitious staff member that wants to kiss up to the board here.
Just what?
Related to this. Yeah.
Related
go
to
find
this
these,
item.
Yeah. 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 Here are my headshots.
When we put issues on here that have multiple issues in one action item.
Yeah.
I think we should at some point have a policy or protocol about how to write a recommended board action. If you go to the county and watch their agenda, most of their recommendations are written in a fashion that you just have who voted and who seconded it, and boom, it's done. And the action item becomes the minute order. Not all the time, but sometimes you have to have a minute order. But it's really hard to do them, and it's really hard to write it like an action, and it's even more difficult as when you have just board members, because you can't communicate how to do it. If you have a general manager, he can help formulate an action because he knows what some of the other, what the board members are most likely to vote on. So it's just something to stew on for a while.
Yeah, and I've been noticing this too in my role as secretary. So thank you.
Yeah,
that up.
If you get that multiple thing in there,
yeah.
You know, somebody had to point us back, Peg comes back to us and says, oh, you didn't cover half this. So we're done with four, I think, and we're moving on to five.
That's right. Five is consider action and recommendations regarding obtaining office space, phone service, and internet.
So with that regard, I put a call into Dennis Bezanovich at the CEO's office, who referred me to Matt Pontes, who referred me to the third district, who referred me to the CEO. And Mona's supposed to call me this afternoon. My suggestion was, is could we have that space where the third district was? I haven't even toured it yet, but in my career of the county, that used to be the credit union. And I borrowed money from that credit union in 1978.
That's cool. But you gotta get the credit union back.
So one of the things I was trying to stress to them is, well, we don't have any money, can I have it for a buck? And I think I'm gonna get pushed back on the buck, because there's some kind of restrictions, because this is bought with redevelopment money. About, now we meet the criteria about this has to be, can only be used by government agencies until the expiration of the bonds. The bonds have a couple of years to go. There was something when the third district was in that office is that if they didn't treat it as a shared office, then you had to pay lease payments, and I can't remember why. So I'll explore that with.
Do you know if they were treating it as a shared office?
Yes.
Okay, that's what I thought.
So Bob, first question, what was the response from the third district?
The response was, you need to talk to Mona about the restrictions.
But was there concern from the third district about giving up what has been historically their space?
They are trying to, I think as Doreen had that, they didn't use it very often. And so they didn't use it at all. So I think Joan, following in the footsteps, realized that, you know, you can have a presence in IB in a different way other than just having one of your staff sitting there like a potted plant. And so I think that's what the thought is. But I think it would be really good if we had a presence in this building.
Absolutely.
And hopefully there's some secure areas. Does it open up?
It's usually locked.
I think it was locked the other day when I tried to walk in there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and the other thing you should know is it was being discussed in terms of the sobering center.
I definitely heard that issue is dead.
Well, it depends who you talk to. Yeah. It's not dead. It's got a couple of tubes going in it, so it's on life support. But the dream is alive. What's dead is how to fund it. But I also think that in my conversations with Joan, she wants to get breathe new life into it. And so, but that's not to say that that space doesn't have, you know, has to be where the Sobering Center is.
Right.
The other issue is not to lose my job, but one of the things to talk to the county about is that if there does need to be, if their feeling is they can't give it to us for a dollar, maybe it comes out of our LRDP commitment. I don't know if that's, I mean, just
I told Mona in my, I did send her an email and said, look, we'd like to have at least a 3-year plan, so we'd like to pay you $3. But if we can't do that, and I understand there might be some restrictions, then tell us what the lease payment would be, and we will try and fundraise for that. And you guys were always in the back of my mind because I know you offered some potential money for that.
Well, there's $200,000. This is not the $200,000.
Oh, a different.
This is the LRDP match grant that's being used right now for streetlights.
Oh, okay.
Street lights, that traffic signal, and sidewalks. So the idea is that money is to be used and matched by the county. And this is where there could be some interest in this, because the county would then create the match.
Right.
Being, you know, given, in other words, they can invent a match.
Right.
And we probably wouldn't. It just has to fit within the LRDP guidelines, which say that our joint efforts are be to improve safety in Isla Vista.
Yeah.
And so I think you have to broadly say that by establishing this office in Isla Vista, we're assisting in efforts to improve and upgrade safety in Isla Vista.
You know, Mona might have something in the back of her mind that she's reserving that for something else, but I don't know. I haven't talked to her.
My thought on this is that space hasn't been used in a long time. We use it when we do art shows in here. Right now, it is filled with long-range development plan, Isla Vista master plan. It has a few essential key Isla Vista documents. In thinking of this whole space as community center space, I mean, I am a supporter of Sobering Center. I'd love to see it somewhere. I don't want to do anything that would bog that down. But maybe in the meantime, that could be kind of a community space that can be used by the 3rd District if they are out here doing meetings. It could be used with important documents related to Isla Vista. And then it could be used by you guys. And maybe we find someone else, that, you know, some other community organization, you know, the temporary spot for something to do with that community, you know. Just somehow make it not just one entity, but several different entities with the whole idea of being, you know.
I was a little bit of the feedback that I was getting, so I'll kick that around.
Yeah, I have enjoyed having all those great documents inside of there, and it would be nice to have a repository.
Yeah.
You know, and have you guys
that's going to be part of something that we're going to need, is because we're going to have to build our own repository for all this stuff that we now need to keep on record. Right now, it's just sitting in a filing cabinet in my house.
The other thing that I was hoping that there was some closets over there and stuff.
There's a desk, and there's a bookshelf, and then there's a big storage room that holds chairs and stuff like that, and a restroom.
Is there like a lock? Is there a place we could? Well, we could probably put. I was hoping that at some point, the reason I was thinking as a district thing is, it'd be nice if we had a mailing address. It would be nice if we had a phone number. It would be nice if we had, you know, internet access, both hard and web, and you know, maybe we could get a server in there that would actually give us some, you know, connectivity with. You know, even if we had a, and you know,
one of Gina's suggestion was, well, let's say this was hard for Spence to get this room. That room's big enough to at least fit us in there, I think.
Right.
For probably up 10 chairs.
That could definitely
be. What you want to be careful of is that it's not, doesn't look like a gift of public funds to another governmental agency.
You can contribute.
Which is why if you have it be a multi-use space.
Yeah.
You won't run into that.
But
problem.
There's no such thing as a gift of public funds to another. You can make contributions to other government agencies. Simple. Just do it for a buck. We do it all the time.
But the issue is using LRDP funds for that.
You're going to come up with a more. So here's what I would suggest is that you come up with a county solution to that and keep the university out of it. LRDP is on its good track.
But if they want us to pay lease rent, we'll.
Well, here's the thing.
But I hear your side too.
If you put interns in there, if you put university interns in there, we're now up to where the we're going to talk. It's broadly within your.
I think I get the drift, and I hear the side on the community space. If everybody thinks that works,
but we could get equipment if we have university interns in there. It's a lot easier to get equipment,
like phone, internet.
From the
filing cabinets
in order to provide the interns. If you can get the space, I think the university would be agreeable. I can't speak for them.
Yeah.
But I think that it would be a nice pitch to them to say, look, we're going to have four interns in there. They're going to cover it so that the office is open so people want to come in. And they need a phone and they need a computer and they need a internet access.
Yeah. Okay.
What do you mean by university?
That's an agenda item that's on for tomorrow's interim committee.
Yeah, I think now we're getting into stuff that's not in our committee's jurisdiction.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm happy to talk to you about it after the meeting.
So do you guys have any other ideas on space, or should we make a motion that we direct me to continue to talk to the county about the potential use of this space?
I think this space holds promise.
Okay.
Yes, I'll make that motion. I move to direct guys to continue discussions with SBC on use of 3rd District office space.
And I second.
The other thing that, at least from one of the assistant CEOs, was, well, why don't you just take over the whole damn thing? And I said, oh, everybody would be happy to do that.
Take over the whole building?
Yeah, the whole complex is under the control of the CSD, but, you know.
There's already some entrenched interests upstairs.
Yes, I know.
So
but you guys are upstairs, right? Yeah.
That's what I said. Mm-hmm. They're entrenched.
And you're paying.
Yes.
Yeah.
All right, so let's do a voice vote. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Motion passes.
Are we done with
We're done with five. Number six, consider making recommendations to the board of directors regarding obtaining legal counsel for the district.
Okay. So a couple things regarding this that I'll start off with. So someone that I've had the pleasure of meeting over the last couple of months that I know you've worked with in the past, Bob, is Shane Stark. Who's the former county council for Santa Barbara County.
Give me the hamburger defense.
Huh.
No, I'll tell you the story.
Okay. Shane has been really interested in the entire CSD process. He's been in regular contact with organizers for Isla Vista self-governance over the course of the process, and was, I would say, one of the most avid Facebook commenters, as Jonathan can attest to, regarding making sure that we are in the loop about all the requirements that we were stepping into, especially once we got elected. And I sat down with him and had lunch last Friday and talked to him a little bit about what he thought we should do in regards to legal counsel. And one of the things, you know, his first question to me was, do you have any money? And I said, no, we don't have any money for legal counsel. We're going to have to get some sort of a solution to be pro bono. And so he was adamant that it's something that we need to be pursuing, though.
That we what?
That we need to be pursuing, and we need to be pursuing it soon. I know that even in the last meeting, it was kind of, it felt to me as a board member like we were kind of walking on eggshells without the presence of legal counsel, and I think it's going to continue to kind of feel like that. Because, and the same thing goes for insurance, even though that's an entirely separate item. But there are, we're in this weird limbo phase, and I think that this is like one of the first steps to getting out of that. I recently was reached out to also by Jennifer Smith, who's the president of Santa Barbara Women Lawyers. And she was offering to, that if we go out for some sort of a an RFP or something like that regarding pro bono legal counsel, she was offering to circulate that among different organizations that she's involved with, including the Santa Barbara Women Lawyers and another organization too. I think it was the local bar organization. But with that, I don't know if any of you
did Shane volunteer.
Did Shane volunteer? No, he did not.
I don't even know. Did he say he's practicing?
No, he didn't. But he was very adamant that he really covets his seat on LAFCO as the public member. And he mentioned to me that that would be in
conflict.
That would be in conflict.
Yeah.
In
conflict.
How about Barry Capello?
Is he retired?
No.
One of the things you know, getting up retired counsel is they have to keep up their license, and not all of them do. I'm a retired CPA, and I just had to take 20 hours of continuing ed, and that barely got me to continue.
The other thing is we need somebody who's got experience in
municipal government. Yeah, that's a big thing. When Shane, he came to a Board of Supervisors meeting a while back and gave Ethan and I printed copies of CSD government code, and he had his bar number on there. So I'm pretty sure that means that he's still practicing.
Do you think that Shane would help us write a
RFP for
a pro bono attorney?
I think it's definitely something that we should look into.
Okay.
Definitely.
Okay, so I'll move that we explore the possibility of putting out an RFP for a pro bono attorney who has government experience.
I'll second that.
Any comment from members of the public? Any requests for proposals? Or is it proposals or for...
RFQ. Sometimes it's RFQ request for quote. Sometimes it's RFP request for proposal.
Well, I mean, I think our quote's going to be uno dollar.
Yeah.
Who was the former city attorney of Santa Barbara who succeeded Barry Capello? He was the assistant under Barry. Who was that?
No, he moved to... he moved, though.
Okay.
Oh, the assistant city? I know the city... attorney after Barry, he moved.
Who was that?
That was, he came back and worked for us on the county formation committee. He's been gone a long time. You know, here's the hard part. Are you going to be able to get an attorney and come in and sit through, you know, hopefully they're not meetings like we had.
Yeah, well, I agree.
Yeah.
I agree.
And I the kind of help we might get may be, you know, them reviewing the agenda, them reviewing our action items, and not necessarily coming and having to sit through all the meetings and give us advice on motions and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah, I mean, the organizations with big money, the county, Goleta West Sanitary District, their attorney sits there the whole time.
Yeah.
We only call our attorney if there's, we never have them sit in our meetings. But if we have an issue or if we have a question, send it to the general manager and send it that direction. So I think this is for specific, like you said.
Is it still Tom Stone?
No. Uh-uh.
Maybe we get Tom to come.
It's not. You can try Tom Stone.
Why don't we try, what's his name, Steve Americanner?
Yeah. He owes me some favors.
He is a special district guru.
Yes, he is.
Yeah.
yeah, just
he's about ready to retire.
He only wants about $300 an hour.
He's making a
okay, so
so that there's a motion on the floor with a second to explore the idea of
all
putting
in
out an RFP. Aye. Okay.
So in terms of proceeding with this, do you think I should take the motion and contact Shane, or Ethan, do you want to follow up and contact Shane?
Yeah, I think that.
Let's see if I have his number in my book.
Yeah, well, this should probably be something. If we want this to be an official thing of the district, it should go to the full board.
Yeah,
and I think the board president should be the one.
I'm assuming that all of the motions and all the actions that we've taken go to the full board.
Yeah,
where they will be.
Yeah. So don't call Mona yet.
Yeah, she's calling me.
But
I'll be careful when I say.
Yeah.
She's hard to get a hold of, so
yeah.
If she calls me, she's
yeah,
a bunch
exactly.
of people.
But yeah, I think that, I mean, that's definitely, again, something that'll come to the board, but it certainly makes sense to have the county appointed representative to the CSD be the point person for interaction with the county. So I think that, yeah, but in this situation where this is just a general thing, it should be the board president.
I just wonder if it would be okay for one of us to call Shane to have him pencil something up for us.
Yeah, I don't
that
think it would hurt.
That would maybe speed things along if it went up to our board what we were asking for.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Sounds it didn't go out without it being reviewed by the entire board and approved.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Not that.
Okay.
So it's just, I don't know what to write.
Chair guys, we have 20 minutes left.
Do we have 20 minutes left?
We have 20 minutes left, and we have one more item, which is going to take an hour and a half. So I don't want to be the impatient one.
Okay. Number 7. Discuss recommendations regarding committee status as a Brown Act committee.
Is this the one that we've pushed everything down to?
Well, we have a little bit of coming back to that. I just want to know what you guys think about this being a Brown Act committee. Well, let me just hand this out. I think I can hand this out now.
Okay.
Thank you.
Well, I agree. From our own internal point of view, it's a pain if it's a Brown Act committee. But if it's going to discuss and deliberate on really important matters for the next year, I think from the public's point of view, it should be a Brown Act committee.
Yes.
Right. So here. So let me just go through these real quick.
Okay.
You know, so I started this off with the little mission statement, establish administrative services. I said we should finish by December. This committee should be over by December. You know.
Okay.
And as start, I inventoried the basic services, tools, policy strategies that the district will need to utilize in the first 2 years of operations and for long-term operations of the district. This is just my initial shot. The way I did it is, I called up the state controller website for counties, and I went through their chart of accounts to trigger my brain to do ideas of things that would need to be in a budget. But this would be something that I'd want to send around to the public and to the full board and say, and this would be a way to, this is kind of what, how I run the county. We put things on a list. Now, I would call these risks. We don't have good communication, so this is a risk sheet. And then we as a formation committee say, what are we going to do about these risks? And then if we solve them, boom, we got a telephone address. We got a district email address. We say accomplished, and it's a way to keep track of what you're working on, what you're accomplishing. We could also, you know, some of these are solutions based on budget, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I just tried to, you know, put these on communications, insurance, and I put on all the kinds of communication, all the kinds of insurance, memberships. You know, somebody suggested to me we'd be part of the local CSD. Papers, bindings, mailing supplies. I don't know how you guys are paying for all this now, or is it all ad lib?
Provided by members of the board. I know Jay printed a bunch of copies of agendas. I use my free prints at the Pardall Center,
yeah.
Which is, yeah.
It's not a sustainable solution. So yeah.
Are you saying we can't talk about this?
I'm not sure if we can be talking about this right now.
Okay, so this is why, this is why,
Under
Brown, if we're talking about whether we should be a Brown Act.
Well,
I only put this on
be
as an
here.
Example.
We can move
this
back to one.
Eight, number eight, I'll focus on the future agenda items.
Yeah.
I mean.
Put this under eight.
Okay, we'll put it on eight. So we're going to open number eight and talk about a future agenda item.
Okay.
But I did put this on here to be an example of the difficulty we'll have if we're a Brown Act committee, because you can't get stuff on the agenda because we don't have any staff to get the stuff on the agenda. When I, if you guys call, if one of you guys said, the only thing you guys can send me is a one-line email that doesn't discuss the issue.
Yeah.
And I'm, and then I have to interpret that and put it on the agenda, and it just seems like it's a thing, it'll never be efficient.
Yeah, but, and that's kind of something I'm running into when I do agendas for the board, and I mean, I did these agendas too, but I mean,
so,
I can tell you, yeah, I mean, this is not sustainable. Like the work of noticing, it, I mean, it's gonna be basically three meetings a week for committee meetings, one or three meetings every 2 weeks. That's the other thing is, and I mean, I don't want to get too far deep into number eight about future meeting dates, but I mean, I anticipate that this committee is going to have to move quickly on its feet to accomplish a lot of these things.
So this is my method to keep myself going and working with members of the committee to say, you know, at some point we're going to run into professional services. I think our current thing is we don't want any employees because we can't afford to have any employees, and we can't.
We don't even have policies in place.
We don't have any payroll to have any. We can't run payroll, so we should do everything by contract. You know, and make it clear that we're hiring contractors that know what they're doing to help us out. Like if we had a general manager, I would just say they get a scope of work and we can't direct them on what to do or they're becoming employees. It's the same with the volunteers. You know, we got all those publications and legal notices. I just put on here rents and leases of equipment. We get it donated, that's even better. I put on treasury and accounting services. If we got a donation today, we have nowhere to deposit it. So we have to make that decision fairly quick about setting up the treasury.
Well, and I think that those, and a lot, well, maybe not so much the treasury, but although actually maybe the treasury, that those are questions of policy.
See, I don't get it. That's just a formation thing. The law says the county treasurer is your treasurer. Once they're your treasurer, you go set up a fund with the county auditor, boom, we can do donations. And so the only other policy issue there is if you wanted to be your own treasurer. And
which we don't want to do.
You don't want to be your own treasurer because it's just like,
well, you're going to have audits and you got to pay an auditor and blah, blah, blah.
No, we got to pay an auditor already, but on the treasurer, you have to do your own investment policy. And then to have your own investment policy, you have to have a treasury oversight committee. And then to have a treasury oversight committee, you know, it's just like, you just don't want to be your own treasurer. It's not very smart. Yeah. And if we eventually become a CSD and get sophisticated, you want the support of the county's auditor's office to help you do it.
Yeah. But so let me, before
conversation
we, well,
for
let's,
a different
yeah, yeah,
I mean, group, of which some
yeah,
of you are
let's,
members
let's
of.
Bring it back to the,
yeah.
the,
careful, guys.
The well, proposal at hand, or not the proposal, but the item at hand, which is recommendations
so I wanna,
regarding
yeah,
the
I
want to
move this. Let me see if I can make a motion.
We're back on seven.
We're on seven.
We're on
eight.
Seven.
We're on both of them, but.
Well, we're on seven.
Okay. Chair, what are we on?
We're on seven. Consider
Thank
making
you.
Recommendations to the
okay.
Board of Directors regarding the formation committee status
okay.
of Brown Act.
So what I would suggest we do is that we that this is an item that the full board
yes.
should discuss, and that we don't make a recommendation to the full board.
Okay.
And that we pass this item on to the full board, indicate to the full board that this is our future agenda, not to jump to number 8, but this seems to me to be a lot of grist for future agenda,
right,
for 2 weeks from now, except that it's a month's worth of...
It's 6 months worth of work.
6 months worth of work, so...
We want to add to it also.
So can I ask, since you're the chair of the committee, can I ask that the chair create from this 4-page a agenda for the next committee meeting that culls out the highest priorities of this? Because it seems to me this also goes back to this is kind of our goals, right?
Yeah. I think that's going to be something that has to go before the board, because it was specifically mentioned at the last committee meeting. Someone said, well, why don't we just have the chair of the committee make the agendas? And someone said, well, it should all go through the same person.
Say that again.
You mean the chair, president of the board, creates the committee agendas?
No. Someone mentioned, why don't we just appoint one person that's appointed to each committee to make the agenda for that committee? And then what the decision of the board was that it should all flow through a singular person.
You.
And they said, okay, the secretary. So me.
Okay.
Well, that's going to be you know what? That's going to totally bring this entire process to a screeching halt, because you're going to have 8 committees here before we're done. And if you
and that's kind of what I'm trying to get at.
If you're going to approve the... So let's take that back to the board. And it seems to me that the chair... The traditional process of a committee structure is that the chair of each of the committees sets the agenda and then runs the meeting.
So let me ask you, Spencer, what do you think the process is if I turn this into an agenda item related to this being a Brown Act committee? Now, a non-Brown Act committee, meaning that I show the board what our idea is for making accomplishments with the formation committee by having this inventory and laundry list of things that we're going to have to work on as part of formation. Because you already go, well, treasury and accounting is really a policy. And I look at it and I go, whoa, it's more than just policy.
Well, you're right. I don't want to say that it's only a policy. It's more than just policy, yes, especially since we're setting up a lot of this stuff. But I don't want to lose focus of exactly what we're talking about here, which is that the question of who's in charge of noticing these meetings.
Oh, I don't mind if you're in charge of noticing the meetings. I think that the question of how an agenda, if we're gonna notice meetings, then I don't know if this can be a standing agenda item as the work list that we're working on. But
it absolutely can. But I think there's 2 points here. Your point is, and maybe I got confused here. Your point was the board wants you to comply with noticing requirements.
Yes, definitely.
But I didn't hear the board say, and yes. Nor could you do that, because there's committees that you're not even going to be involved in, and so to have you setting the agendas.
Well, I didn't set the agenda. Well, so I'm on 2 of the committees, and so I placed items on those committee agendas that I felt should be on the agendas. For the other ones, I just copy and pasted from what other board
members. Well, I think it's a good, do you agree that it's a good policy to have the chairs set the agenda?
I do.
Following the committee meetings.
I do. So long as we're making sure that when there is the need for compliance, that the chairs are handling the compliance aspect of it.
Absolutely. Which is to make sure that it's in your hands in time to meet Brown Act.
Right.
So I think we're all in agreement that we'll pass this up to the Well, we're getting a little loose here. I just want to make a point is that I want the committee to do discussion. And then when it's public comment time, I want us to have public comment. But I don't want us to have a committee of 7 yet. We will soon.
You guys are ready for public comment?
Yeah. So I think the consensus here is that this is going to, we're going to go to the board. Let me write this down. Consensus. Board. To board discussion. Brown Act or not Brown Act. And then share the work list. And finally, to get the board to agree that the chairs of each committee are going to set the agendas. Which you're on the committee tomorrow? Policy?
Yes.
That's a policy. So you might want to, I don't know if it's on your...
Yeah, but I think it's fine if our committee makes the recommendation that we would like the chair of our committee to be the one creating and maintaining the agenda.
Right. Okay.
I think that is something that we should recommend.
Okay.
Did you put selection of the treasurer onto the policy committee or no?
Selection of the treasurer?
Yeah. I mean, the treasurer is always already the treasurer of the district, but there is an alternative. So I don't think I mentioned it to you when I wrote to you.
I don't know why I would put something I don't know why I would put
on
the policy
committee. I don't know. Okay. Anyways.
So again, sorry, maybe I missed that. So,
apologies
if that
was the
case.
Yeah.
Right. First off, I see that you're punting the idea of should this be a Brown Act committee back to the board, but I'll just add my two cents in. It does need to be a Brown Act committee. You guys need transparency, you need to make sure it's noticed, you don't want anyone thinking that they might not know what's going on with this committee, because these are important decisions being made. The work list, great, share the work list with the full board, but kind of go through and say, well, who should be talking about this? Which, you know, be really clear on which committee has the ability to talk about treasury and accounting services. You don't want overlap, you guys, because you are serious Brown Acting boo-boos. If you guys start talking about treasury and accounting services, but then tomorrow morning they start talking about treasury and accounting services. So make sure that as you go through this laundry list, everyone knows which is where. And then as far as I think that, yes, the chair should make the agenda, but now that you've got meetings up and going, this next item, future agenda dates and items, is a great opportunity for you guys to come to what's the meatiest, most important stuff right now. You don't go into any detail about pros and cons of it, but you do say, we think at our next meeting, we need this and this and this. So, and then that gets, and then I think there does need to be a clearinghouse person. You know, that gets sent over to Spencer, and then Spencer doesn't have to do any work other than press a button and send it out. So there's my thoughts of all of
this.
Well,
you know, one of the things, Pagin, I think those are great suggestions. And in my heart, I kind of agree with you in terms of Brown Act, although my brain says, oh, my God. But in my heart.
Sometimes, but there's a reason
for
it.
Yeah, no, I understand. I was on the other side most of my life, but I do want to say that the thing that you have prompted me to think about is that probably the next committee that we should form is an executive committee made up of the officers, and this isn't on agenda, but I'm responding to the public comment, made up of the officers, and that's where you would have this go for assignment to committee.
Yeah, I totally believe that this list, some of these could get assigned to other committees because their policy, and that's what the purpose of the checklist is, information. Hey, here's an issue, put it to where it needs to go. And then, you know, on here we'd say, oh, if it's treasury and accounting, we think that needs policy first, send it to the policy committee so something gets done. And so this is just kind of a way to manage all these things for formation that need to get done, and then get it done by December. I don't want to be sitting here, you know.
I think it's great. I think this is great.
Oh, okay.
I think along with the 90-day plan, we're really starting to put together the bones here.
Right. And I'm just a guy that wants to get stuff done. Now, another thing on an ad hoc committee, I would never
think about not noticing the ad hoc meetings and having the public come to them and it be a free-for-all. I would rather see it be more open, like we talked to you guys today. We didn't ask for public comment. We just, except for the end, we just got public participation. I thought it worked great. And so, but I think eventually we won't have that many members of the public when this gets really boring. I mean, startup is not so boring, but when it gets farther down the road.
I think there's going to be more public.
What?
I think there's going to be more.
Well, yeah, if we start talking about a property tax exchange agreement that I put in here, that would be less than boring. But
so let me ask this, Spencer. What is the process to get things on the board agenda? What did we finally agree?
The agreement is that members of the board would contact me if it's through email, then it's an email, and it has the item and it has the description.
Okay.
And the only fiddling that I do with it, and this was only done in the case of another committee, but it's just an example of how the process works, is that if I had an item that I wanted to get on the agenda and I wanted to take an item that another board member sent me that was very similar and combine the two so that they were one agenda item, just for I would do that. Yeah.
I mean, the Brown Act is all about, it's all about private property being converted for wealth. That's why, that was the origin of it. You know, we're not doing very many things that are.
All right, we got 2 minutes left. So
okay, sorry.
Yeah. So do we have to come back to anything that we missed?
We do have to set future meeting dates and talk a little bit about the schedule, which is what I had pulled up on my computer.
Let's just set a meeting date for 2 weeks.
Wow. 2 weeks from now, do you want to do the same time in the same place?
It's good with me.
Yeah. Okay, let me just double check before I stick my foot. Totally.
Yeah. Well, hold on. Yeah, let me look at that really quickly. So today is the 15th
Wednesday.
Of March. So next Wednesday will be over spring break.
And we have a board meeting on the 21st, right?
Yeah, we do have a board meeting on the 21st. So theoretically, we could meet next Wednesday if we wanted to.
Oh, next Wednesday is the 22nd.
Yeah.
So if we went 2 weeks out and started doing it, what would that be?
The 29th.
The 29th.
And the 29th is spring break. And so the
29th is spring break.
So yeah, working around the breaks is something that I am going to be bringing to the board in terms of our board meeting schedule as well. So if we want to try to craft out a way to... I think in the interim, we just got to set a next meeting.
So that we'll get some more students here at the next meeting. I think it's really dangerous for us to start right now organizing our government activities around things like spring break. You know, we're responsible for an entire community of Isla Vista that doesn't stop during spring break.
I don't think that's necessarily true. I think it does kind of stop during spring break.
No, it doesn't. The businesses don't stop during spring break. And then,
what
are we going to do
in
the
summertime?
Are we going to take summers off?
No, well, this is definitely something that's going to need to...
Finals week, we're going to do that, and then...
Yeah.
Bring your full board.
Yeah. No, I agree.
We're talking about our next meeting.
I know.
The point that I was trying to make is how far out do we want to go in planning our next meeting?
Our committee meeting?
Yeah. Well, we have to choose a next committee meeting date. We can't punt that.
I'm thinking that we have to wait for this, you know, for a little bit of direction from the full board if we're going to give this committee list forward and we're going to try and switch it to an ad hoc committee. And even if it's a Brown Act committee and we can continue this to be our agenda and the board agrees, we'll refer stuff off here and use that as how I do the agenda. I just want a list of tasks that the formation committee needs to accomplish by the end of December. I think we need to have the ability to add tasks as we think of it and to finish tasks. And that's just sometimes one of these could turn into a big project, meaning we're going to work on it as a project. Like, you know, so
yeah.
I'm just looking at a way to make us efficient as a committee.
So what I'm hearing is, number one, this document needs to be formalized. The board needs to vote on it and make it an official document of the board and delegate certain tasks to other committees. And the possibility of creating a committee, that's something that's before the board. That's not something we can control.
I would say this is going to go to the board for a concept of the formation committee reports,
mm-hmm.
and how we're going to organize our business of the formation committee and get their buy-in. If they come mm-hmm. up with the ideas and say, we want to refer this formation committee, it gets
yeah.
on our list. If they want to take things off and assign it to another policy committee, we say, went
but,
to policy.
Yeah, but what you're saying, though, is that this is how this long laundry list of things that we can do would be essentially a standing agenda item for formation committee meetings.
Yes. It would
okay.
be.
Okay, so
would
that's
be,
what I'm saying.
Yeah.
So we need to recommend that this be an official, like, that the board approve this essentially and or not necessarily approve it in its current form, but delegate certain things to.
I just want them to approve
yeah.
the method, which is we're going to add and take away things from this
okay.
list, and it's a way to keep track
yeah.
of our accomplishments. That's what my intention is.
Yeah,
and,
no, I
and
understand.
I only
yeah.
did
I'm just
this
trying
all
to
by my little self, you know, and said, hey, I want everybody's input, you know, and
yeah.
I only did this because I'm an accountant, and that's where. I know all this stuff
yeah.
will come up.
No, I understand. And I think, I just want to say for the record, I think this is great. And
if anybody can think
valuable.
Of somewhere else I should go, I don't know if CDS, what's their name?
CSDA.
If they have a formation packet, I doubt it. Somebody wrote me and said they got a good policy committee packet. A good
yeah,
policy.
They have a draft policy manual.
Yeah.
Again, that's not within something that we can consider.
So did we decide, are we going to meet in 2 weeks? I still think we should meet in 2 weeks.
Can you meet in 2 weeks?
I won't be here in 2 weeks.
Okay.
Not on the Wednesday. I mean, I could meet earlier in the week, in 2 weeks.
Yeah, when Wednesdays are my best days, I can meet again next week. That would be after the board meeting. We wouldn't have time to get an agenda out, though.
No, not if we wanted to.
Well, why don't we put this on the agenda? Why don't we agendize this?
On the board agenda.
No, on our agenda.
On
we're
our agenda.
We're about to be asking the board to.
Oh, that's a good idea.
Well, they're going to approve it. I mean, what?
Yeah.
So
okay.
we just
well,
put this
fine.
On the agenda, and then with the idea that we're gonna just brainstorm it for an hour and a half, where
yeah.
we go, okay, hey, we all agree, here's what we need to do next,
right?
And here's some possible action items on this one, and da 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 da. I mean, this is the elephant, and I think we can eat maybe the trunk by December.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But one bite at a time.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's things on here that. We'll only maybe get a staff report out on. So, anyways, gotta
okay.
go. Are we done?
Well, we need to set a next meeting.
Oh, set the next meeting. The 22nd, we are gonna go.
Didn't we just say next Wednesday?
Next Wednesday.
Works for me. Same time and same place.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah, let me just make sure.
Make. I mean, get here on
same
time.
Time.
This
what
time?
Time.
3 o'clock.
3 o'clock.
3 p.m.
Okay.
So then I'm going to send you, just I'm going to send you the minutes of this meeting that will include recommendations to the board that you can then agendize. So I will try and have those to you no later than Friday. Is that
that sounds great. And you should
okay.
send them a copy of, you should send a copy to Bob as well.
Minutes to Bob.
Yeah, because Bob's going to be writing some sort of written report, or we haven't voted on that yet. We haven't directed
report
to
the board.
Oh, could I do a report? Can I do the report to the board and include this in it?
Also, I think your report to the board is simply going to be under
what we accomplished.
Yeah.
And the report. Yeah, and I thought that what you had spoken about in the meeting was written reports so that we can just file them because. We're going to find ourselves, and again, maybe this isn't necessarily a conversation for this
body, although it is because it's related to the formation, is that as we keep on forming more and more committees and we have these regularly meeting working groups, we're going to have a lot of reports sitting on the desk. And you're right, it's going to take up a large chunk of time if we end up just delineating every single thing we do in verbal form.
And I agree. And so the minutes become the report.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And so you that's it. Otherwise, what you're doing is you're having people read the minutes, and then you read the minutes.
Yeah, right. Yeah. I agree.
So just, I have a board like that, and
If we're a Brown Act committee and we continue to do minutes, then the minutes become the report to the board. If we switch it to an ad hoc committee, I would envision some form of what we accomplished on our task list as a report to the board.
Okay.
Great.
Do we need
move to adjourn? Move to adjourn.
Second.
Move to adjourn. That's what I'm supposed to say.
Yeah.
Oh,
wait, yeah,
anybody can move to adjourn.
You can't
second.
Make all in favor.
Aye.
Are you going to, is Robert's rules?
Thanks for the public comment.
I'm pretty sure that.
Are Robert's rules going to be on the agenda for the main board?
I believe that's something.
Natalie,
I believe that's
on your committee.
I think that's something that the policy committee is talking about in regards to board procedures and rules.
Does that mean I'm going to have to go read Robert's rules again? Because Natalie's all over Robert's rules. She was murmuring over there. Robert's rules.
Yeah, I know. Well, we didn't adopt Robert's rules at the last meeting.
We didn't, no. But I think we should. Don't you?
It's an issue for the policy committee.
There we go. Yes.
That's,
no, we're adjourned.
That's all that I want to say is we're adjourned.
Good job, Spence.
Yeah. Thanks, Bob.